Hello and welcome to the third of our films for this year's Self-Denial Appeal. This week I'll be talking to Richard Bradbury. Richard and his wife Heidi have been serving in Bangladesh for the last 2.5 years. They're there with their two children, and they work at the headquarters in Dhaka, the country's capital. Bangladesh has about 100 offices and about 1,000 soldiers. The country's population is increasing, especially in the cities. Dhaka has twice the population of London, but is 5 times more densely populated. These images were filmed by a team from the Canada and Bermuda Territory for their self-denial appeal last year. When I caught up with Richard, he was not in Bangladesh, but quarantining in Denmark, which is Heidi's homeland, as the family took a well-earned Christmas break. Well, it's really great to be chatting with you, Richard. Can you just tell us what's it been like for you in Bangladesh?
Like many places, it's been a very challenging time. It wasn't just a healthcare issue, it was more an economic issue. So many people are on daily wages. And so to not have any income during that time had some really serious implications. And when you live in very crowded conditions, whether it be in, you know, a house that you're sharing with your extended family, or when you're living on top of each other in a slum area, then transmission is much, much quicker, and it's much harder to isolate things.
There was a post you made about seeing some of your international colleagues flying out. Literally, you could see their planes going over where you lived, and you could almost just see that could have been you, but you stayed with the people. How difficult was that decision to stay?
In some ways, it was not very difficult. I think for us, we felt, well, actually, you know, We have this tremendous privilege of living in another culture, and we can't only do that during the good times. That actually, if we are truly believing that this is our calling, this is where we are supposed to be, then that has to be during the challenging times as well. We can't just take the good bits. So yes, there were struggles in our minds, particularly at the start, around the lack of the healthcare, and that was a risk, there's no doubt about it. And that's why many people went. But for us, I guess at that point, we just had to believe that our faith was stronger than our fears at that point. And we just wanted to stay and journey along with our colleagues.
How is church life continuing in Bangladesh?
During the initial lockdown stages, we had to, like many places around the world, we had to close the churches, but we don't have the benefit of Zoom or Skype or these issues. Many, you know, it's often said that places like Bangladesh, the Salvation Army is not for the poor. The Salvation Army is also the poor, you know. So many of our soldiers live in poverty, but our officers did a remarkable job just keeping everybody connected, and that was how we kept going until we were able to gather together as a church.
Perhaps in the last few years, but certainly this year, I guess people have been thinking about what is resilience. Is that what you're saying? Is that something you've really seen in the officers and Salvationists in Bangladesh?
The Bangladeshi people are tremendously resilient, and the officers reflect that in their responses. And so we weren't just dealing with the response for COVID. We have dengue fever. We had a response for cyclone where we were helping people to rebuild their houses. They'd lost their house completely. A number of our halls and quarters were literally just blown away at the same time as we were trying to deal with the fallout from COVID as well. It was the locals that really stepped up in the response. So we were able to coordinate things, but actually the majority of the work was done by the local officers, the Salvation Army officers on the ground. And they did an amazing job. You know, they went out often without concern for their own safety and did all kinds of things. And then we also have a number of clinics And we were able to keep those open. I paid real tribute to the staff of those clinics that just kept soldiering on.
Yeah.
And I mean, another thing that I would say is that actually during this time, we've also had our self-denial appeal as well. And I'm always keen to stress that the International Salvation Army self-denial appeal is one that everybody gets to contribute in. And okay, we get more from that whole pot, but we still have the privilege of being part of that. And for many people here, it's a real act of self-denial. So that also emphasizes this idea that, you know, we stand together as Salvationists and Christians in solidarity, and, you know, this togetherness and connectedness that we have.
Well, if you can send the Salvationists of Bangladesh just our love and our admiration and acknowledgement of our brotherhood and sisterhood with them.
Thank you. And we are also grateful for the support that's been given to us, the financial support, yes, but also, you know, the compassionate support and the concern that's been given to us as well.
Thanks, Richard. Speak to you another time.
Yeah. Thanks.
Next week, I'll be talking to Melinda Boone in the Philippines.
Hello. As always, it's a real pleasure to greet you in the name of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ, to this our virtual worship. My name is Andrew Bale and this is my wife Tracy, and together we are responsible for leading the Salvation Army in Southend-on-Sea.
To start our worship today, our opening song is Be Thou My Vision. I hope you enjoy singing it with us.
Be
In a few moments, Tracy is going to pray on our behalf. And after she's prayed, we're going to listen to a lovely new song called All Along. It's sung by Bethany Smarden, who grew up at Southend-on-Sea, but moved away when she went to university.
Let us pray together. Father God, we thank you as we focus today on your love. We thank you that we are loved by you. And I pray, Father, that my friends who are joining us today will sense that love in their own hearts just now. I pray for those in particular that are struggling at the moment, perhaps those that are shielding and feel isolated from the rest of the world, who perhaps feel lonely. I pray, Father, that today, just now, right where they are, they will sense your presence and know that they are loved. Father, we try and understand your love sometimes from a human perspective in the way that we love each other. But it's so hard to understand because you love us beyond anything that we can love another human being like. And so, Father God, we pray that today we just get a snippet of that love, that immense love that you have for each and every one of us, and that everyone will feel blessed as they come into your presence. We ask this, Lord, in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Through things that you knew would not.
I thought it would be fun today to sing four familiar choruses. If we were in the hall and we sang choruses like this, we would probably pause in between each one and listen to an inspiring and encouraging testimony. But sadly, nobody has sent us a testimony to share. So take this as a little reminder that we want to hear what God is doing in your life during lockdown. But let's sing these choruses together anyway and make them our own personal testimony as we sing.
The Bible reading is taken from Matthew chapter 20, verses 20 to 28.
Then the mother of Zebedee's sons came to Jesus with her sons and, kneeling down, asked a favour of him. "What is it you want?" he asked. She said, "Grant that one of these two sons of mine may sit at your right and the other at your left in your kingdom." "You don't know what you are asking," Jesus said to them. "Can you drink the cup I am going to drink?" "We can," they answered. Jesus said to them, "You will indeed drink from my cup, but to sit at my right or left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those for whom they have been prepared by my Father." When the 10 heard about this, they were indignant with the two brothers. Jesus called them together and said, "You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be your slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many."
Now we're going to listen to our own community gospel choir. This is a recording from 2016 when John Mitchinson was still the leader of the choir. John, together with his wife Rebecca, now leads the Salvation Army in Kirkwall in the Orkney Islands. And the song the choir are going to sing to us is "Joyful, Joyful." We're very grateful to our core pianist Dennis Evans for taking the time every week to record piano music which we listen to during the offering. And Dennis is now going to play to us that beautiful song from the pen of Graham Kendrick, "Servant King," as we wait upon you for the offering. Well, I don't know what it's been like where you are, but last week we were battling with snow in Southend, and we asked the parents of the children if they could send us in some photographs of any snowmen that they might have made. And we're going to look at those pictures as we sing our next song, which is Doug Hawley's children's song, Fan Dabby Dozy. And those of you that are eagle-eyed may notice that one of the snowmen is actually a snow woman.
Today by asking you a question. Have you ever been in love? Hopefully everyone who is listening has at some stage been loved by another, even if that was simply a parent or sibling rather than a romantic love. But I guess what I'm talking about here is that giddy mixture of emotions that we feel when we are in love. I wonder if you believe in love at first sight. Andrew has always told me that the very first night we went out together, he went home and knelt by the side of his bed and asked God if I could be his wife. That's Andrew's wife, of course, not God's. Andrew has no doubt whatsoever that he fell in love with me the first time we met, whereas it took me a little bit longer to fall in love with him. But then Andrew is a bit of an acquired taste. He seems to be a little bit like the human equivalent of Marmite. You either love him or you don't. Well, I for one am certainly glad that I stuck around long enough to fall in love, because next year we will have been happily married for 30 years. When you're in love, the focus of your attention is the object of your affection. You would do anything for the person you love. Listen to these quotations from contemporary love songs. The first one is from The Proclaimers. I would walk 500 miles and I would walk 500 more just to be the man who walked 1,000 miles to fall down at your door. Or how about this from Marvin Gaye? If you need me, call me. No matter where you are, no matter how far, just call my name. I'll be there in a hurry. You don't have to worry, because there ain't no mountain high enough, ain't no valley low enough, ain't no river wide enough to keep me from getting to you. Or perhaps you prefer this one from the Jackson 5. I'll be there to protect you with an unselfish love that respects you. Just call my name and I'll be there. I'll be there to protect you. I'll be there to comfort you. I'll be your strength. Or if love songs aren't your thing, perhaps a quote from a film might help. One of our favourite films, one which we watch every single year, is It's a Wonderful Life, starring James Stewart and Donna Reed. In that film is a scene where the two of them fall into a swimming pool and have to walk home in clothing they've managed to find in a changing room. And on their way home, they pause at an old empty house. There is a legend associated with this house that if you throw a stone and manage to break one of the windows whilst making a wish, the wish will come true. As was the case with my relationship with Andrew, it seems pretty clear to the viewer that the character played by Donna Reed already knows that she is in love with George Bailey. But it was obviously going to take him a little bit longer to realise that he had also fallen in love with her. But as they stand in front of the old house, he turns to Mary and says, "What is it that you want, Mary? What do you want? Do you want the moon? Just say the word and I'll throw a lasso around it and pull it down. Hey, that's a pretty good idea. I'll give you the moon, Mary." When we are in love, if it were possible, we would do anything we could to please our partner or make them happy. When you are in love, there is no hardship in carrying out menial tasks for the person you love, because when you are doing something for someone you love, nothing is menial. I think it would be fair to say, and I'm sure that Andrew would agree with me, whatever we do for each other, whether it's preparing dinner, doing the ironing, or something more romantic, everything is done with the same amount of attention to detail and affection, because every act is an opportunity to show each other how much we love each other. When it comes to being in love, it's not about what we get, it's about what we give. It's not about the things that are done for us, but about the things that we are allowed to do for each other. I can remember reading a quote once that said, "We fall in love with people not because of what they do for us, but because of what they let us do for them." I guess this is equally true in all loving relationships, not just romantic ones. My mother-in-law, Joy, loves to tell a story about Andrew when he was a little boy. At the time, he used to get half a crown pocket money, and he gave his mum a card and a bar of chocolate for Mother's Day. It was the 1960s, and in the card that came with the chocolate was an old penny. When Joy asked him why he put a penny in the card, he replied, "That was the change from buying the chocolate, and I wanted to give you everything I have." When we love someone, whether it's a spouse, a parent, a sibling, a child, or just a best friend, we want them to be happy, and we use everything at our disposal to look for opportunities to serve them. A couple of weeks ago, I preached on Acts chapter 20, verse 32, where Paul quotes Jesus. Interestingly, the words Paul quotes are not in any of the Gospels. We only know that Jesus said them because Paul shares them with us. The words were, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." And in that sermon, I spoke about how important it is to allow others to make us the recipient of their generosity. For the Christian, not only is it more blessed to give than to receive, it's a lot easier to give than to receive. And if we aren't occasionally prepared to allow ourselves to be the target of somebody else's kindness, then we are denying them the blessing that comes from giving. Although we can see from experience that when people are in love, the most important thing for them is their ability to give, we don't often, if at all, apply this logic to the most important relationship we have in our lives. In John chapter 3, verse 16, we are told that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. In 1 John chapter 4, the apostle reminds us that God is love. In the same chapter, in verse 19, John says that we love because he first loved us. There is plenty of scripture that suggests Christians love because they are loved. They give because they have received so much. They sacrifice because of the example of Christ on the cross. I wonder if perhaps we have forgotten to enjoy the love Christ has for us. I enjoy making Andrew breakfast and taking it up to him with a fresh cup of coffee in the morning. But I also enjoy those moments when he surprises me with breakfast in bed. Fortunately for me, since lockdown began, he has generally got up long before me, and so when it comes to providing breakfast, he's probably in credit. And that's not because I get up late, it's because he gets up ridiculously early. The challenge we face when it comes to our relationship with Christ is that we have been taught since we first became Christians that Christianity is about what we can do to serve others. It's about self-sacrifice. It's about taking up our cross and following Christ. This idea has been drummed into us. Do you remember that famous quote that President Kennedy used in his inauguration address? "Ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country." For many Christians, if you replace the word country with Christ, Kennedy's quote is a fairly good description of their understanding of Christianity. Horatio Bonar was a prolific hymn writer who lived in the 19th century. He wrote, among many others, the hymns, "Fill thou my life, O Lord my God, in every part with praise," and "I heard the voice of Jesus say, come unto me and rest." But in another of his hymns, which we find in our songbook, he writes, "Go, labour on, spend and be spent. Thy joy to do the Father's will, it is the way the Master went. Should not the servant tread it still?" What some people don't realise when they sing that song is that it was inspired by the King James translation of 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 15, where Paul says to the young church, "I will very gladly spend and be spent for you." This idea of literally being spent on Christ's behalf for the sake of others is central to our understanding of Christian faith and practice. Can you imagine being in a relationship, a human relationship, where all you were allowed to do was to be the recipient of someone else's constant love and affection, but you were never allowed to love them back. Imagine receiving every day gifts of chocolates, flowers, and poetry, but were never allowed to send any gifts back. Imagine a relationship where you were able to receive the love of another, but were never permitted to indulge them in the same way. We need to remember, perhaps, in these difficult circumstances that we find ourselves in at the moment, more than any other time, that God loves us. And sometimes what He wants from us is nothing other than allowing ourselves to be completely submerged in His love. When was the last time you allowed yourself just to bathe in the love of God? When was the last time in prayer that you brought nothing to God but empty hands, ready and willing to be the centre of His affection? Song of Solomon is a fairly graphic book, and I've often wondered how it managed to find its way into the Bible. But I believe it's there because it shows us the intensity of the love that God feels for us. In Song of Solomon, chapter 7, verse 10, it says, "I belong to my beloved, and his desire is for me." We are, again to quote Song of Solomon, the apple of God's eye. Occasionally, we need to allow Him to dote on us. It is in such moments of being loved that we find the strength, the resources, the grace, and the healing we need to serve others. In the Bible reading we shared earlier, the mother of James and John, perhaps encouraged by her sons, revealed to Jesus that she had no real understanding of God's kingdom when she asked if her sons could be given positions of honour and respect. In his response, Jesus reminds us that if we want to be great, we need to learn to become a servant. We need to follow the example of Christ himself, who came not to be served, but to serve. How is it that over time we have focused almost entirely on only one part of this verse? We have focused on our responsibility to serve others, but as Dennis reminded us when he played during the offering, Jesus came to serve. In that song, Graham Kendrick says, "From heaven you came, helpless babe, entered our world, your glory veiled, not to be served, but to serve, and give your life that we might live." That song was published in 1983, and it's a song very much about service. But in 2013, Kendrick added an extra verse which says, "We bring our lives to you, a sacrifice for you. In view of love so true, we are changed, renewed." I'm glad that he added those extra lines because it reminds us that although we're called to serve, everything that we are as Christians is created by, empowered by, and sustained by the love we receive from God. So this week, I'm giving you permission to be loved by God, to be doted on, to be the apple of His eye, the object of His affection, because it is in being loved that we learn how to love. To help us in that process, I'm grateful to Tracy Pease, one of our fellowship here at Southend, who sent us a link to a beautiful new arrangement of the traditional hymn, "O Love That Wilt Not Let Me Go." As we listen to these words, as we are moved by the music and by the images that Andrew has put together, I hope and pray that you will open up your heart, let down your guard, become vulnerable, and enjoy the love of God in all its fullness, even though, as Paul reminds us, it is beyond our comprehension. Just bask in his love without thinking about what he might want you to do or where he might want you to go or what he might want you to say. And just yield completely to that love which will not let you go. God bless you.
Oh.
Well, thank you for taking the time to join with us this week. I really do hope and pray that you will take Tracy's advice to heart and that this week you'll make time for God to come and love you and to hold you in his arms. We're grateful to our fellow Salvationists across the pond for bringing to us our closing song today, which is that contemporary song of praise, We Bow Down.
People of God, be encouraged. In spite of what you're going through, this is an opportunity for us to send a little hope your way. No matter what it is, the struggle, no matter what's happening, you be encouraged. Let's do it. Here we go. Woo!
Well, we're going to listen now to our benediction, which is brought to us this week by the International Staff Songsters of the Salvation Army, and they're singing that beautiful song, Thou Wilt Keep Him in Perfect Peace, Whose Mind is Stayed on Thee.
And after we've listened to that, the details of our coffee Zoom will come up on the screen, and we'd love you to join us if you're able to. You don't have to be a member of our church here in Southend. Anybody can join in, and it would be a pleasure to meet you.
God bless you and stay safe.
God bless.
Thank you.